community author teams. So welcome to Devopedia, and this session is mainly meant for new authors, and we are going to introduce the Devopedia web app and how you can use the app to create your first article. So in this session, you are going to learn all the nitty-gritty details of how the system works and all the different features that you will find useful as an author. So we'll begin. During the session, I request you to mute your microphones. And when you need to ask a question, you can always unmute yourself and ask. So it's all discussions and Q&A are allowed, except that when you are silent, keep your microphones muted. So that will help us avoid background noises. What is the outline of today's talk? We are going to start with the introduction to the Devopedia web app. Then we are going to look at how you can create an account. It is very trivial, nothing complex here, but a few things we will cover: how you can configure or customize your profile, and how you can what are the new features that get enabled once you have an account and you log into the system. Then we'll look at author resources. As an author, what are the things the system provides to help you with the authoring process? Then we come to the main part, which is the key, which is where authors are going to get paid. So that is the rewards program, and we'll talk a little bit about the rewards program, including the process. So this will cover how you write, how you submit for reviews, how the reviews happen, and how the payment is made or when the payment is made. So this whole thing is supposed to take 45 minutes. It may take less, but with Q&A, I guess it will come up to 45 minutes. After that, we go to the second part of the talk, which is where we will understand how you can create your first article on Devopedia. This is not like a workshop. I will go through how to create, but you are not going to follow it step by step. You will do this at a later time when you are actually starting to write an article, not now. Then there are author tips. We will share how to do research, how to do writing for Devopedia, and finally we'll conclude with a summary. Okay, so this is another 45 minutes because the whole thing is quite a long session. We might have a break in between. Maybe we'll take a short break in between. 5 minute break. So I hope that sounds interesting to you. So let's get started. Now, I don't have a lot of slides in these sections because these are going to be mainly a demo. So we are going to go to the live site and see how these things work. So let's start with the introduction to Devopedia. I have here the homepage. So devopedia.org. And so I am now in the home page. Most of you would have already visited the site, and you would have got some understanding or some idea what type of content we publish and how the content is organized. So on the home page, we are mainly featuring some articles which have been recently published or some popular articles and articles under certain tag. For example, this is an article on material design. It's under the tag of design. This is an article on BERT, which is a language model that's coming under the tag of algorithms. So some specific articles are featured on the site. And if we click on any one of those, we will go specifically to an article page. So this is the typical structure of an article. All articles have the same structure. The article starts with a summary, short summary, where we introduce the topic or summarize the topic to the reader. And this summary is typically very important because if the reader doesn't understand the summary, the reader is not going to read the rest of the article. So as an author, it's very important for you to present the summary in a simple language, in a language that they can understand. Basically, the summary should help the author understand the topic quickly rather than confuse the reader. So the reader, if the reader is confused after reading the summary, it's very likely that they are not going to read the rest of the article. Okay, so the summary is very important. Then comes the discussion. So unlike Wikipedia, where you have sections, subsections at multiple levels, in our case, a discussion is a flat structure. It is organized as a Q&A. You might say it's an FAQ type of thing. So here we are sort of inspired by Quora and Stack Overflow, which is also a Q&A format. So this is how the discussion is organized as a Q&A. Then the last section that you need to take care of in an important section for authors is the milestones, which traces the development of the technology from a timeline perspective. So 1753, something happened and so on. You, as an author, you may not capture all the milestones because you may not have time to do extensive research, but try to capture at least the main things that happened in the growth of this particular topic. So this example we are seeing right now is A-B testing. So for that, you know, the author has captured some milestones. So as an author, there are three sections you have to write: summary, discussion, milestones. There are other smaller, very minor things you have to do, like tag the article and add C also. So we'll come to that a little later in the talk. So this is the structure of an article. Then there is one more page which is very useful, commonly used. That is the browse articles page, where you can see all the list of articles currently published, or even articles which are not yet published, but they are being prepared or being written by authors. So for example, when you are writing an article, you know, visitors will not be able to see the article. But once the people log in, they can see how the article is progressing. So that's also very useful. I'm getting some background disturbance. Let me just check. Yeah, Anoop's mic was on. Okay. Any questions at this point? Maybe you have unmuted to ask a question. If there are any questions, we'll take it now.
No, there are no questions that I have.
Okay. If so not, then we'll continue. Oh. So that's about the Devopedia web app, homepage, browse articles, article pages. Next up is creating an account. There is nothing complex here. Right now I am already logged in, but I'll go to my local installation just to give you an idea how to do it. So this is a local copy of the live site. So I don't want to, you know, fiddle with the live site. So I'm showing it on a local copy. So you can go here and create an account. So you see here at the bottom, there is a link, create an account. And if you click that, it will load this page where you can create an account name, which is your real name. And then if you hover here, you will also give a tooltip, some explanation. Username. So username, this is what will appear on the website. Your name will not appear. Okay. That is provided you have kept your profile as private. But if you make your profile public, the name will also appear on the site. So some authors, they want to remain anonymous, so they can create an arbitrary username. But always put in your real name so that we know who is the real author behind this username. And if you don't want to make your real name visible to the public, you can make your profile private. Then password, email address, confirm the email address and captcha. So all this is standard stuff, nothing complex here. The more easier way, which many authors prefer, is instead of filling this form, you can simply connect to one of the social logins, which is also available here. So this is what, you know, a lot of our authors do. So I can give you that example. Suppose I am already logged into Gmail on this browser, so I can connect to my Gmail using my Google identity. So first time when it connects, it will ask you to fill your name, and this name it retrieves from Google. So you don't have to tinker with this. Then username. So you may not want this username. So you may give some other username. I will say, let's say writer123. Okay. And then my email address. Now, when you fill in the email address, make sure that this is the same email address on which we have been communicating. For example, for this call, you got an email via email invitation. Use that same email address, right? Because that only indicates that you are part of the rewards program. So now you can create your account here. So I have done it by connecting it to my Google identity. And once it's done, here it's a little slow because of the local host. But on the live site, it should be a lot faster. So what has happened is the email. So once the account is created, you know, an email will be sent out to the system admin and so on. But because this is a local site, email has not gone out. So nothing to worry. So your account is created. Username is here. And you know, this is the real name. Next up is you can actually edit your profile. Even after creating, you can edit your username if you want. But this is not typical practice, but you can do that if you want. And then you can customize your profile picture. This picture, you know, has been obtained from Google, but you can customize this if you want. And you can put more information. Tell a little bit about yourself, which is your location. Are you in Bangalore or Pune or Jaipur, whatever, your education, and then where are you working? But all these are optional. Okay. Web presence. What is your web handle on, let's say you have a website or a blog, you can put that handle here, your LinkedIn, Twitter, GitHub, and so on. But all this is optional. You don't need to do it if you don't want to. Then preferences. So this is where, you know, you can make your profile public. So I'll give you two examples of users. One example is Anuradha, who is one of our authors. So Anuradha has made her profile public. So you can see some information, her LinkedIn handle. She's in Bangalore. This is her name. And yeah, this is her username. But she has not given more information, like what is her background and stuff like that. So that is up to her choice. Then we have another profile, Ramanathan, who is also an author. So Ramanathan has shared his picture, data scientist, Bangalore. His background is statistics and finance, and a little bit description of his experience. So the beauty of the profile page is, as an author, you get recognition on the site. So all your contributions, like at least the recent contributions, are shown here. Plus the system rewards you with bronze badge, silver badge, gold badge. So in case of Ramanathan, since he is a data scientist, he has written a lot of articles on data. So the system recognizes this and it has awarded him a bronze badge. Now if he continues to write more articles on data, this will become a silver badge and a gold badge and so on. So that way, you know, people visiting his profile page on Devopedia will recognize immediately that, you know, this guy, these are the areas of Ramanathan's expertise. So that way it will also add value to you, to your profile as a technical writer. And some of our authors, you know, feature this link in their resumes as well. So that's one of the value adds for authors on Devopedia. So that is about customizing the profile, about creating an account, and then about the profile page. So once you log in, what happens? Once you log in, a few things happen. Firstly, a new menu item appears. If you are not logged in, this will not appear, add article. But once you are logged in, this opens up. Then the second menu item is the dashboard, which will give a complete summary of your contributions on the site. Every edit that you make, every comment that you make, everything is captured in the dashboard. And notifications will also come here. The other thing is, suppose you go to a specific article. Let's say we go to an article here, Python OOP. You can also edit the article. So this also gets opened up once you log in. So you can't edit an article if you are not logged into the system. So to edit an article, you need to be logged in. And another thing is, you can also participate in the chat. So here, for example, you can give a comment on this article, what you liked about the article, what you didn't like, or if you have suggestions for improvements, you can write them here and submit. So the authors of this article will get notified automatically, and then they will reply to your comment. So that way you can start a discussion. But to participate in the comment, you should be logged into the system. Okay. So these are the things you can do as an author. You can also like the article, but for liking the article or liking any chat comment, you don't need a login. Even as a visitor, you know, without logging into the system, you can like the article. I will pause here. In case you have any questions, we can take questions. A short pause. Yeah. Okay, no questions, we'll carry on. So we have covered how to create an account and looked at the public profile page, adding, editing articles, comments, and so on. So we'll go into adding and editing article more detail here. Next up is, as an author, what are the resources you have at your fingertips to help you in the writing process or even in the research process? So if you go to the site, we'll go to the live site. The first and the most important thing you should read is probably author guidelines. There are also two other pages about Devopedia, which is like a high level overview of what Devopedia is all about. You guys might have already read it, so we'll not go into it. Then there is another page which is terms of use. So this is more of a legal requirement. What are the definitions? What is the overview? What we provide? Disclaimer. How you can participate on the site. Privacy policy, which is important. Licensing of the content and so on. So you can read about it. I'm not going to go through that. Author guidelines is what is mandatory. And there are many sections here, you know, overview, user roles, article lifecycle, content guidelines, and so on. So make use of this section, read all of them in detail because it will help you later on. The reason is if you don't read this and start writing, what will happen is your contribution may go through unnecessarily a lot of reviews. But if you read this in advance before you start your research and writing, the reviews will be less because you would have already understood what the reviewers are expecting. And what, how the content is supposed to be written, styled, and published on the site. So this author guidelines is, I would say, mandatory reading for all authors. To get started quickly, you can also read this section first, good and bad examples. So instead of reading a descriptive way in which you know all these are explained, you might want to read these examples. So I'll give you one example here, opinionated. Python has pandas for data preparation that has cool features. This is written, let's say, by an author. But this is opinionated because we typically don't want to use words like this. Wherever you use adjectives like cool features, it suggests that it's an opinion created by the author, especially if it is not backed by citations. So try to be a little bit more neutral. So this is what is a better way to write the same sentence. Python has pandas for data preparation that has many useful features, a little bit more factual. And the author is also backing it up by giving a list of some of these features, such as multi-indexing, handling missing data, and detecting outliers. Right? So this is a bit more neutral, bit more formal, or you can say business-like. Whereas this is, you know, typically not recommended on the site. So this may be suitable on a blog, but not on Devopedia because it creates sort of an opinion. So like this, there are many examples here. You can read them. This will help you to understand quickly and easily how to write for Devopedia. Okay. So that is, these are the author, these are the resources that are available, author guidelines. Yeah. Now let's say you start writing an article. Let's say I add an article. The syntax that we follow is called markdown syntax. And the article has to be, there are many fields to be filled in this article. But the beauty is for the author, even if you are very new to this, there is help, plenty of help available everywhere. So this is help on title, how to select a title or what kind of characters are allowed in title. So some suggestions are given. And similarly, tags. You can always click on the help, understand how to fill up this section. So typically when you're writing your first article, this help section will be very useful. But once you have completed your first article, you would have already understood the system. So you would not need to refer to the help anymore. But at least when you are writing your first article, I am very sure that these help sections will be useful to you. So make use of these help sections. Then there is also a help on the markdown itself, how to write markdown and examples of markdown. So a lot of help is there when you are editing or adding a new article. So not to worry on that account. Then the last thing is, which we'll cover later as well, you know, some of you may be wondering, how do I select a topic for publishing, right? So there is, in if you go to FAQ and help, there is a section here, requested articles. So here we have handpicked like 2000 plus articles, which are waiting to be written, but we are waiting for an author to come and select one of these topics and write about it. So if you want, you can, you know, filter it. Let's say I'm interested in Java, so I can filter it Java and see what are the topics on Java that I can write about. Or if I'm interested in, let's say, security. So I will get a filtered list of topics which have the word, you know, security in the title. So with this, you will be in a position, okay, I want to write about DNS security. So you can select a topic of your interest from this list. But you need not be restricted only to this list. You can also propose your own topic. So we'll come to that later in the presentation. Okay. So this is another thing that is, you know, that could be useful for new authors. So that's it about author resources. Now we come to the rewards program. So this is the main thing that we want to talk about. So you, some of you joined a little late. So I mentioned in the beginning that most of the articles you see today on the site are written by volunteers. But with volunteers alone, we are unable to scale. We typically get maybe on average one article per week. But we want to scale that maybe to 5 articles a week or even 10 articles a week. So to enable that, we have started this rewards program where we are going to pay authors for their contribution. And in that process, you know, you guys were selected after a round of interviews. And this program, by the way, is not available to everyone. It's only for those people who have been selected through this round of shortlisting and interviews. And in case if any of your contacts or friends or colleagues want to be part of this program, they are welcome, but they have to first send their resume. They have to go through the same process. They will be shortlisted and then interviewed before they can join the rewards program. Okay. So let's go through this rewards program and the process that is involved in it. So these things we have already covered: creating an account, author resources, so rewards program. So some people asked during the interviews, you know, is this a job or is this a learning opportunity? So you, because we are paying you, you may treat it as a part-time job, that's fine. But how we like to see it is we are actually paying authors to learn, right? But it's not also a training program. It's not like a training or placement program. We are paying you to learn, but you have to learn it on your own. You are going to do the research. You are going to do the hard work. Yeah, you are going to put the content together. So we are paying authors to learn, but more importantly, after learning, you are going to share that knowledge with the world. So there is a little bit for both of us. You know, for you are going to learn a topic that is of your interest. For us and for the overall developer community, whatever you learn, it's going to be available for everyone. So you are learning and then sharing that knowledge with world, with everyone. So this is, the way we like to think of it. It's not like a job opportunity that we are giving you, but we are paying you to learn and then share that knowledge with everyone. Now, if this is the case, how do you select a topic? So what we tell people is, first you have to look at your own interest. Suppose you are interested in object-oriented programming, or you are interested in data science, or DevOps, or cloud computing, or 5G. You know, you have to select a topic in your area of interest. That is most important, because if you are not interested in the topic, what will happen? You will treat it as another job. You will treat it as another assignment, and you will not get, you will not do justice to the research, justice to the topic. So to do good research, you have to get interested in the topic. That's the first thing. And second thing is expertise. So this is not so important. You may be a complete beginner in Python, but if you have sufficient interest, you can learn it. But if you have a little bit of expertise on Python, maybe you can write the article in 3 days. Instead of taking 1 week, you can write it in 3 days. So expertise is not essential, but it helps you to reduce the time for research. That is the only advantage in picking a topic in which you already have some knowledge. And the last thing is research. So even while you are picking a topic, it is good to do some amount of research, at least 15 minutes, half an hour, just to get a feel of the topic before you make that proposal to us. Okay. So think of these three things, interest, expertise, and research. And when these three things come together, it is almost guaranteed that the article that you are going to write will be of quality. Because you are definitely interested in the topic, and you are going to do research, and you are probably having some expertise, or you are going to gain that expertise through research. So it is guaranteed that the article will come out good quality. Now let's look at, so I already mentioned to you in our FAQ, there is a list of articles which are already like handpicked. So you can pick from that list, or you can propose your own title, right? Either approach is fine. So how should you, what's the typical proposal? When you tell us, I want to write about this particular topic, what should you inform us? Two things you have to give us. You have to give us the title of the topic and the set of questions you will be covering in the topic. Okay, these two things you have to inform us. So this is an example. Let's say the author wants to write about this topic. So the author has given the title, Explainable AI. And then the author has listed a set of questions. All the questions are good. What is explainable AI? Is explainability in AI same as interpretability, and so on? So this is the kind of proposal we want. Nothing elaborate, just two things, title and a set of questions. So take a look at the first question. What is explainable AI? Actually, this may not be a question when you actually publish the article, because this is typically covered in the summary. So it may not go into the discussion, but it's okay. We can reorganize that information later on. Take a look at the last question. What are some limitations of explainable AI? So don't always praise the topic. Maybe the topic is of great interest to you. You like this topic, but that doesn't mean that you should write only good things about the topic. Definitely everything has limitations, shortcomings, performance limitations, maybe design limitations. So capture those things here. What are some limitations of explainable AI? So this makes the article more complete and neutral. So the reader who is reading this article, they will get a good complete picture, overview of the topic. Take a look at these two questions. What are the current techniques in explainable AI? What are the different frameworks for explainable AI? So there is nothing wrong with these two questions. In fact, we can answer them briefly. But if I look at it, because I am an experienced writer on Devopedia, if I look at these two topics, immediately I will say that these two have so much scope that they can be separate articles on Devopedia. So there is no harm covering these two questions in this high level article, but it's very likely that the content, when you talk about explainable AI techniques, there will be so much content out there, it can be a separate article on its own. Same thing for explainable AI frameworks. This also has a lot of scope to become a separate article. So when you define your define the scope of your article, also be aware what parts of the article can themselves be independent articles. So that's also something you have to keep in mind. So what are the types of articles this is simply to give you an idea what types of articles we are publishing. It could be about a concept, about technology, about product, application area, comparison, about technical organizations. So I'm not going to read through it. Maybe I'll just give one example. Dead code, it's a concept. Blockchain, Python OOP, these are concepts. These are technology areas, but I mean, these are not like mutually exclusive. So Python OOP is I treat it as a more like a technology article, but also there is a concept of OOP. So there is some overlap with the concept theme as well. So as an author, you don't have to really bother, you know, where it actually falls, because this is not captured in the system. This is only for this presentation, just to give an idea. We can broadly classify the types of articles we publish under these themes. So what would be a product? Kubernetes, that's a product. PyTorch is a product. Application areas, most of these are like algorithms, speech recognition, question similarity. Comparison, where you compare two things, Python 2 versus 3. JavaScript frameworks, which will give an overview of many JavaScript frameworks and also give a comparison. Types of mobile apps. So these are like comparison articles. An organization like IETF, that's an organization. So anything related to technology, those kind of organizations can be mentioned. So we can have articles on those. So already I touched upon this, defining article scope. So this is an example, first we wrote an article on Python, and after writing an article on Python, the author realized that Python is a very huge topic. So other articles got started. So you can see on Python alone, we have so many articles identified. As an author, you should be aware of this. Try to pick a narrow topic. Suppose you pick something like Python iterators. It is very narrow, specific, and easy to write about. Whereas if you take a top level article, usually it is a little bit more difficult, because to summarize a huge topic into a short article, you have to take a lot of decisions, what you should cover, what you should not cover at the top level article. So as a beginner, I would recommend you pick up something that is a little bit narrower, like magic methods in Python or Python ML frameworks. Right. So this is how you define the scope of an article. Mind you, each of this is a separate article on Devopedia.
Yep, Arvind, Anirudh has a question here.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, Anirudh,
yeah,
you can ask.
Actually, the thing is, though you have answered one of my question, so my second question is that as in when we write about an article, right? So do we have a word limit for that?
Yeah, those things are coming up. I will be sharing those things. Yeah.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
Yeah. So these are some examples that you should not write on Devopedia. So these kind of titles I actually picked up from online just by Googling. So on Medium blogs or some other blog. So somebody has written an article, Philgo versus Flutter versus React Native, which one to choose in 2021. this is not something we are going to publish on Devopedia. First of all, this sort of a title is only suitable for a blog. But what we can write on Devopedia is we can have separate articles on Felgo, Flutter, and React Native, separate articles. Okay. We can also write one comparison article like this, cross-platform app development frameworks, which will cover all three of this, compare all three of this in a single article. But we won't have something so specific like this, Felgo versus Flutter versus React Native. No. Instead, we can have something like this, cross-platform app development frameworks. Okay. Next example, step-by-step process to learn Python faster. So again, we are not like instructables or any tutorial site where we are teaching people step by step to do something. We are trying to help developers understand things at a conceptual level, right? So whatever is written in this article, it's relevant to developers, but this kind of a format or focus is not suited for Devopedia. Instead, what we can do is we have, of course, an article on Python. So in Python article, one of the questions where we can mention what are the useful resources for beginners or what is the learning path for a beginner. So that kind of a question can be identified in the main Python article, and that will cover, this whatever this article is talking about. It will actually be one question in our Python article. Next up, RCNN implementation from scratch. Again, we are not teaching exact implementations or how to code per se, but we definitely can have an article on RCNN where one of the questions could touch upon some implementation issues. Okay. Funding for startups. So this is definitely more like a business article. It's not a tech article. Even if I say, for example, funding for tech startups, it will not be suitable for Devopedia because the article will be more like a business article rather than tech. So that is definitely a no. 7 principles I follow to design for the enterprise. So this is a blog post somebody has written in Medium or somewhere. Actually, there is nothing wrong with this topic. Okay. We can write this in Devopedia, but the title should not be like this and it should be a broader focus. So the way I would change this is the title on Devopedia will be like this, design principles for enterprises. So in this article, you cover whatever that's relevant to this topic. So you can see the title should be a little bit formal, a little bit impersonal, whereas this is very personal, like one guy expressing his opinions, what he has learned. But because our site is unopinionated, we should take a different viewpoint. So the title also reflects that. So these are some examples. Another example I can share is let's say Samsung or Microsoft or Bill Gates. So all these organizations or individuals are connected to the world of technology, but we can't publish articles on them or on their organizations on Devopedia. That is not allowed. You can publish on topics, you can publish on concepts, but not on organizations. The only exception is I showed you earlier, IETF, which is more like an industry consortium or an industry body. So that is a non-commercial kind of a setup. So developers need to know about those things. So those kind of articles are okay. So rewards program, this is the actual process. You create an account, you visit the community rewards program page. There you propose a title and the initial set of questions I showed you earlier. Then the moderator will approve that, right? And he may give some suggestions. Okay, you change the title like this. So minor suggestions. Once it is approved, then you can start your full research and writing. So this will be iterative. Multiple reviews will happen. Moderator will give suggestions to improve the article. And then once the article doesn't have any warnings and it meets the minimum criteria, like 1200 words, and it has come up to quality, moderator will do the final edit and publish it. And after that, for the first article, you will submit your bank details for the payment. And once those details are received, a moderator will initiate the payment, so which will come to your account within 1 or 2 days. So typically you will get the payment in your account 1 or 2 days after the article is published. That is provided you submit the bank details immediately. Now there is a time bound for the article. Once the moderator approves the article, you have 4 weeks to complete the article. In case for various reasons you are unable to complete in 4 weeks, you can be granted a 2 week extension. Okay. And there are other things which I will cover a little later. One more thing I wanted to tell is, it's possible in some cases that an author may decide to abandon the article. That means they have done gone through a couple of reviews, but either they don't have time, or they lost interest in the topic, or suddenly based on the review comments from the moderator, suddenly they find that the topic is a lot more challenging than what they can handle. So in those cases, they can come back to Devopedia and tell us, please assign this article to some other author. So then moderator will find another author, and that second author will complete the article. So when the second author completes the article, you will get paid according to your percentage of contribution. So typically you will be paid 4,000 rupees for the article if you complete the entire article on your own. That means you go through the review process, implement all the comments on your own, and the article comes up to quality, you will get paid 4,000 rupees. But if you hand over the article to a second author and the second author completes the article, then you will be paid according to the percentage of contribution. But in any case, you will get paid minimum 2,000 rupees for the article. So that we guarantee. And the process and the place to submit your proposal is also given here. But today, if you go and read this page, you will get outdated content. So the content will be updated only on 12th of December, which is next Sunday. So from 13th of December, the site will be usable. But this page, you can take a look. This process is documented there as well. But there will be some differences. So that those changes will go online on 12th of December. Any questions at this point? I'll give a pause here.
Hello.
Yeah, go ahead.
Is this open for writing, say, before 12th December, or would it start only on or after 12th December?
Yeah, the whole process starts only on 13th. On 12th, the changes will happen on the site. From 13th onwards, you can start using the site.
Okay, but let's say I decide to write on a certain topic. Should I wait till 12th December, or that process can begin before 12th?
No, you have to wait till 13th. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yes, Arvind.
Yeah.
I just wanted to ask that if a writer confirms a topic, then the same topic would not be given to any other writer, right?
Definitely. Yeah. It will not be given to any other author.
Okay. That's it.
We can take one or two more questions, if any.
Yes, Arvind. I have a minor doubt here.
Yeah.
I didn't understand properly if the writer lose the interest or he gave up on writing the article after the first iteration or the second iteration.
Yeah.
Then how will be the payment terms and conditions for him?
Yeah. So what will happen is second author will complete the article. And let's say there is a percentage, let's say the first author contributed 80% of the work. Second author only did 20% of the work. Then according to the percentage contribution, we have some slabs. Then the author will get paid, maybe not 4,000, they may get paid 3,500 or 3,000, depending on the percentage contribution.
Okay.
Yeah, got but it. Minimum the author will get paid 2,000.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, so now somebody asked about word limit and all that. So before you submit the article for review, these are the minimum requirements that the article should meet. It should be minimum 1200 words. There should be no warnings. So every article, the system will throw warnings if the article doesn't meet minimum quality. And as an author, you can see those warnings easily. It is very obvious. So once you reach this 1200 words, no warnings, and as a researcher, you will know, you know, one, that you have justified the topic. You have done good research and you have covered it in a very new, like in a very exhaustive manner or in a complete manner. So you should be happy with the work that you have done. Then you can submit it for review. And every review, you make sure it has 1200 words and then no warnings. Okay. What are the warnings? So somebody asked, you know, word limits and all that. So everything is covered here. Some warnings will appear on the client side. That means on the browser when you are editing. Some warnings will appear on the server side. That is, after editing, you submit the article, then the server will do further validation. And if it doesn't like something it sees, it will throw a warning. So these are the warnings or sort of limits which the system checks. Summary is only 150 words or less. Right. So these are the maximum limits. Summary should be 150 words is the limit. Discussion, 2000 words total. But for every Q&A, there is a word limit of 200 words. Milestones, there is a word limit of 100 words per milestone. What about the minimum? So we need a minimum of 500 words for the entire article to remove the warning. To publish and pay the author, we need a minimum of 1200, which I already shared in the previous slide. Okay, these are the minimum word limits. So for 1200, no warning will appear. It is only a like a soft limit. The system is going to check only 500. This 1200, the reviewer will check. But you know, the reviewer sometimes is a little flexible. If the article is, let's assume 1150 words, reviewer will say, fine, that's good. That's fine. You have covered the article well. You have the quality is good. So we will not be so picky about 1200. So you can say it's kind of a soft limit. If it's falling short by 50 words, 100 words, that's fine. It's not a big deal. Main thing is article should be of good quality. Other limits, article should have at least 3 images, videos or audio. Usually nobody uses audio. So common things are images and video. Article should have at least 3 question and answers in the discussion, 3 to 5 milestones, 15 milestones, 3 to 8 tags, 3 to 6 see also items, 3 to 6 further reading items, and something about references and citations. So these things the article, the system will check and throw warnings if any of these are not meeting. Right. You will understand a little bit more about this when we start creating our first article. And this one, see also, it links to other articles on the Devopedia system. So you can, as an author, you can identify some other articles, but the reviewer may edit this because he or she has a intimate knowledge of other articles on the system. So they may edit it so that it links correctly to the other articles. So now we come to some interesting things. So Mark Twain, he's an American writer, humorist. He lived mostly in the 19th century. What is important is what he said. Okay, so why is this important to us? So this goes back to the previous slide where we have word limits for everything. Now, don't think that because 150 words is so short, it is easy to write the summary. Actually, to write the summary, it takes a lot more time and effort, mainly because of this. Right? It is very easy to write a long article, but it is not so easy to write a short, precise, concise article, which gets directly to the point. And the same goes for any of the question and answers in the discussion. So it's easy to write something to answer a question in 500 words, but if you have to answer it from in 200 words, suddenly it becomes much more challenging. Okay, so that is why, unlike other sites, you know, some of you are technical writers by profession, you would have authored you know, content for many websites. Many of these sites, they pay by what is called as price per word. This is the metric they use. They pay 2 rupees per word, or 3 rupees, or 4 rupees per word. But this price per word doesn't make sense on Devopedia, because we believe this, right? The number of words you write is not really reflective of the quality of the article, or you know, the effort that you have put in, particularly when an article goes through multiple versions. So that is why we don't use the metric price per word. So you can't simply take 4,000 rupees and divide it by 1,200 words. You can do that, you will get some number, price per word, but that is not the equation we use, right? Because that doesn't make sense to us. What we use is word count is only a guideline. We use many other things. We count how many references you have included in the article, how many citations are there, how many images are there, how many milestones. And all this, including the word count, are translated to something called DevCoins. And it is this DevCoins, it is like Bitcoins, but for developers, right? So it is this DevCoins which is used for the final calculation, not the number of words directly, because there are many other factors which are used. And like I said, system validates and displays warnings, and article goes through multiple reviews and revisions. So because of all these aspects of how review and writing happens on Devopedia, the price per word metric, which is typically followed by other sites, don't make sense on Devopedia. So this is very important to understand. Don't simply compare, or don't divide 4,000 by 1,200 to get a number. That is not how it works. And when you write your first article, you will realize the value of this, because this is a more accurate representation of the amount of effort the author is going to put into the article. And finally, you are the author, you are talking about the content, and somebody else has to read it, and they have to make sense of what you are writing. So as an author, what is your responsibility, or what is your approach? The more time an author invests, less time a reader requires to understand the topic. So this is very important. You know, who is our customer? Reader is our customer. So if you do good amount of research, if the article is of good quality, then your reader is going to have a very easy time understanding the topic. So reader is our customer, and we have to do our best to make sure article is presented in such a way that the reader understands it easily. So this is the responsibility of an author. So any questions? Probably we'll take a 5-minute break, and then we'll come back for creating your first article. Before that, we can have some questions.
Yes, I have a small question.
Yeah.
What about the references? How do we keep them in an article?
Yeah, that's coming up in the next session when you are creating your first article.
Okay.
So we'll cover that here. Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions for the?
I also had a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, sir, is it a contract? Is this contract with Devopedia? Is it a time-based contract? Like, is this 1 month or 2 months, any certain time limit?
So actually, it's a freelance opportunity. So there is no contract as such. But what we are going to do is the first two articles that you write, we will use it sort of like a testing ground for both of us. So from our side, we will see whether the first two articles are of good quality. That means you have proven yourself as a good writer for Devopedia. Then we will say you can continue to write more articles. So we will give a invitation to you to produce more articles to Devopedia. And from your side also, these first two articles will be like a testing ground. You can figure out whether you enjoy the process, whether you enjoy writing for Devopedia. So from your side also, it's a it will be to your advantage.
Got
and
it.
So that's what, but even for the first two articles, although we treat it as samples, you will get paid according to the process we have discussed.
Got it, sir.
But reasonably, the expectation is, I hope that authors who sign up, they write at least one article per month or two articles per month. That is a reasonable expectation. But if you are a good author and you are producing quality content, you can write even four articles a month or even eight. There is no limit as such. The only limit I see is the funds. Because we are funded through donations. So if the donations are not coming, we will tell you in advance. This month, you know, you can write only two. So that is one constraint you have to be aware of. But typically, you know, we will make sure we get the donations in place so that we can pay you. But you will know this before you start writing. It's not that after writing, we'll tell you that we don't have the money to pay you. That is not going to happen for sure.
That's great, sir.
Yeah. So, okay, we'll take a 2-minute break. The call will be still on. And we are going to come back and see how to create your first article. So this is this is going to be a demo. And after that, we'll look at a lot of interesting slides, how to do proper research and how to write for Devopedia. So just stay online, we'll be back. I'm going to switch on my camera so you know what's happening here. So shall we continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. So let's begin. Ramanathan, how many were there in the call earlier? I hope everyone is back. Yeah.
Yeah, all of them are there.
Yeah, okay. So we are going to see how to create your first article. And let's see. So typically you will go here, add article. Before that, let me cover this one. Yeah, I showed you that there is a community outreach page. So the outreach page will become like this, where you can propose an article. You give the title and a list of questions. Today you will not see this on the live site. This is I am showing this on my development site. But on 13th of December, you will see this on the live site. So then you can submit your proposal in this manner on this page, on the community outreach page. Give the title and a list of questions and submit it. And even after submitting, you can edit the proposal. And a reviewer will take a look at that proposal and give back and give you feedback comments whether the proposal is accepted. Once it is accepted, what you do, you go to add article. And then you can add the same article here and then the discussion questions and so on. So this is how it is going to be. So let's say I'm going to start writing that article. So somebody give me a topic, what you want to write about? Anybody? Just this is just an example.
Introduction to Java.
Introduction to Java.
Introduction to Java, right? Is that what you said?
Yes.
Yeah, so now that kind of title we don't accept, but what we can do is we can type Java as the title. Because it is understood that the whole article is about introducing Java. So our title will not be introduction to Java, rather it will simply be Java. And if you want to make it explicit, you can say Java language. So this is allowed, right? So let's say this is the title we want to give, Java language. Then what else? I will increase the font size if you want. Tags, what are the tags? So now because this is a Java language, the first tag I will use is languages. And then I may even say programming, right? Programming, okay, programming. And Java is an object-oriented language, yes? So I will select another tag, object-oriented. So like this, I think you can select up to 8 tags, if I am not mistaken. So maximum 8 tags are allowed. Okay. So these tags are simply to help the system understand what kind of article it is. So I have selected 3 tags, languages, programming, object-oriented. And out of these 3 tags, this is the primary tag. So there are some tags which are primary. You should select at least one of these. Mobile, embedded, design, languages, tools, data, algorithms, networking, security, testing, system. These are the primary tags. So every article should have at least one primary tag. And you can have multiple primary tags also. You can select, nothing wrong with that. And you can add secondary tags as well. Suppose you want to add a tag which is not there in the system. Let's assume hello world. This is nonsense. You can't have a tag like this, but I am showing this as an example. So hello world, it doesn't exist in the system. So that's why nothing comes up. But you can create this tag by typing the tag and then pressing enter. So the system allows you to create tags which are not currently existing. So you are allowed to do this. So now what is happening? The author has created one tag and he or she has selected 3 tags already existing in the system. So simple title tags, change description. I will simply say first version because we have not yet started writing. And here you will talk something about Java. Introduce Java, right? Highlight main features, whatever you want to do about Java, that is the summary. Then discussion. So remember, discussion is like a Q&A. So now what are the questions you will identify? So I would say, what are the main features of Java? Okay. What else? Anybody?
Alternatives of Java.
Huh?
So alternatives of Java, like other OOPS languages.
Okay. Not sure, but okay, let's just list it. Another thing that comes to mind is particularly to Java, which I will put it earlier. What are the flavors of Java? What do I mean by flavors? Anybody knows?
Sir, it's version. It's version. It's version, sir. Different versions of Java.
Yeah, what I mean is the answer I'm looking for is J2E. Then J2SC, is it? Is it SC? There is an enterprise version, standard version, and then mobile version. So I don't know, but this is what I have in mind. When I say what are the flavors, this is what I have in mind. Standard version, enterprise version, mobile version. Okay. So like this, you can identify number of questions. And you will give the answers. Right, so you will write the answers for those questions. For each of those questions, you are going to give the answers at a later point. Then what else? So that is about milestones and that is about discussion. But there is one problem here. I will do a preview of this and you will see what is happening. When I do a preview, this is the summary I wrote, but nothing in the discussion is coming. Right? The reason for that is I have not formatted the discussion correctly. So the discussion must be formatted as a list because this is a question. How will the system know which is a question, which is the answer? So questions are preceded by an asterisk space. So this is markdown syntax. So wherever you have a question, you put an asterisk and a space, star and a space. Now this is markdown syntax. System recognizes this. Now if you do a preview, you will see now summary has come, then the questions have also come with the answers. Okay. So before submitting the article to the system, always do a preview to check whether it is displaying correctly, whether your edits are okay. So that is important. So now let's do a couple of more things about markdown, right? Let's say today is a Saturday. Let's do a preview of this. Let's see how it comes up. Today is a Saturday. Let's assume that I want to make today as bold, this one as italics. How do I do it? I'm showing you in markdown. So to do that, double star. This one should be double underscore. And when now if you do a preview, you will see that change here. Today has become bold. This one has become italics. So these are very basic stuff. If you look at the examples, you will understand. This is how to bold the text. This is how to emphasize the text. And you can have a sublist. So you can put a list here, right? I can say, maybe not here, main features of Java. So I can see here, main features are, I will say four spaces star something, four spaces star. So now if I do a preview, probably I did not put four spaces. One space is missing. So now if I do a preview, you can see I get a list. So sometimes you want to write content as a list inside the answer. But you can have only one level of list. You can't have a list inside a list. because we feel that this is sufficient for readability. So these are some of the things. Then block code. So this is also useful. Sometimes, you know, I'll show you an example of an article, maybe DevOps metrics. Leave page, yes. So you can see in this article, there is a quote which the author found it very interesting to read from an original source, and they have quoted that sentence exactly as it appears in the source. And this is like eye-catching for the reader. So the author is saying something important, and probably it is useful for the reader to know this. So it's an important part of answering this question. So that's what it is. So to get this kind of format, you use this block code. So if I have to demonstrate that, I can put it here, do a preview. It appears like this, right? So to emphasize that, but don't overuse it. You can have to one or two in an article, I'm sure. But anything more than that, it looks excessive. So if you want to highlight something, which you found interesting in a source, you can do that. This is for inline code. Suppose you want to write some inline code, you can do that. So how do you do that? You put a backslash, back quote rather, like this. Now if you do a preview, this appears in a different format. So this is including code in your article. Then there is also, you can also include multiple lines of code. This is allowed only for a single line of code. What if your code is multiple lines? You can't do that here. You can't do that in the discussion, but you can do it here in sample code. So here, samples are there. So for example, I can take this, put it here. So this is another way to get started. I can take that, put it here. And now if I do a preview, you see I got my Python sample code here, in here. Right. So it's in some cases, you may explain it here, but the code may actually appear here as examples. Because within the answer, we don't allow multi-line code to appear. And this goes back to the original requirement, original motivation for creating Devopedia. We are more about the concept, explaining the concept to people rather than teaching them how to code. So that is why code is pushed to the bottom, where here we focus mainly on the concept. Next up, so that is about code. Milestones, simple. So put a date, give a description, review. Milestone appears 2009 and what happened in 2009. Suppose you want to give, let's say 2010, it should be ordered, but in 2010 you also know the month when it occurred, so you give that as well. Review, you can see here August 2010, and some description. So we don't actually support exact dates, because nobody needs to know. For example, it happened on 29th August. Maybe for some milestones the exact date is important. If that is the case, you put it in the description here, but at the high level only month and date are supported. Okay, so these are the two things you have to keep in mind. Of course, this is also allowed, but very rarely you will need, you will encounter a milestone which is BC. So don't worry about it. Yeah. Okay, so that's about milestones. Now about images. Okay, let's talk about images. Now, because this is a new article, we are not able to upload an image, right? So images can be uploaded only from the second version onwards. First version, because no storage space has been created on the system for the first version. If it's a new article, no storage space has been created. So we don't allow any upload of images for the first version. But after you create the article, when you edit the, for the second version, then you can upload images. So that's the only thing. But let's look at embedding a YouTube video, for example. So this is the format. You can simply copy from here, paste it into discussion, and the video will appear. Of course, this is not a valid URL. So we have to pick a valid URL. So let's say I go to YouTube. Let's see what comes up. So let's pick our own video. This is video from DevOps channel. I paste it here. Now I do a preview. So all I have done is taken the URL and pasted it, and the rest of the things are already in place. Okay. So I do a preview. The video appears in the article. This is what we wanted. So some questions, you know, that the author may feel, you know, the video has explained it beautifully. So an example is data science. What exactly is the definition of the term data science? So here author has decided that this video on YouTube is really good in explaining this question, answering this question. So author has simply embedded that video, plus the author has given a little bit more. You know, maybe he is summarizing something in the video, or he is also taking from other sources and including that, you know, in the description. So that is what is possible. So you can embed YouTube videos within an article. Only thing is, when you embed it, you have to give citations. So we have not come to citations bit. We'll come to that shortly. So this is what you call as a citation. So publisher 2014 is a citation, but actually if you see, it should be written like this. This is the name of the guy, right? Gualtieri. And the video was published in 2013. And you give a description, like a caption for the video. What is a data scientist? So the same thing here, like here I would say introduction to design. That is what this video is about. And then I will say, you know, it appeared in Devopedia YouTube channel. So I can say Devopedia YouTube. Can say Devopedia YouTube, but typically we will not cite our own sources as citations. That is not allowed. You should take some external source. But even if you do this, it will throw a warning. Okay. If you go, so here, this is where article warnings appear. As you can see here, so many warnings. So before you submit your article for review, you have to get rid of all these warnings. So I hope it is clear. So all the warnings appear here. Now we are only doing a preview. So let's try to save it. So I am logged in as who? I am logged in as, this is a new ID. So I'll tell you, I'll show you what happens in this case. I save it. So immediately it says, this is the server side error. As I told you, some citations are not listed in reference section. So the system checks whether all the citations are correctly in place. So here we have used a citation. Devopedia YouTube 2014, but it is not listed in the reference. So we list it. Devopedia YouTube. You will learn this better later. And you know, you give a description. Introduction to design, I suppose that is the title. Then you can give the date. I don't know when it was published. Let's say September 1st. And where it was published, Devopedia on YouTube. And then when did you access the URL? Yeah, when you are doing the research, when did you access the URL? So let's say I accessed it today. Then you put this link, and then the link should go in here. So what was the link? Well, we have it in our article, same link we used here to embed the video, the same link. You take the link, put it here. Now if you do a preview, that warning would have disappeared anyway. Some items are cite only external sources. in references, some items are Devopedia articles. Yeah, so like I told you, the system does a check. You cannot quote yourself. So you have to quote some external source. So let's say I will avoid it by doing this. Even then it may throw a warning because system does some checks. So it should match here. Don't worry about this if it looks a little complex. So now you see the warning has disappeared. I should be in a position to save it. Now the article is saved. Your edit has been saved as a draft. You may continue editing. A moderator will review your latest draft. So the reason this happens is because you are a new author to the system. So you don't have enough trust on the system. But once you start writing more and more articles, automatically you will gain the trust in the system, and the system will automatically allow you to create a new version. So currently what is happening, it has gone to a reviewer for review, but you can continue editing the article. So that's not an issue. So any questions at this point? So I have covered the main things. I will show image upload also here. So after that we'll take questions. So let's take this live system, Devopedia. If I want to upload an image, what will I do? I will go browse and then pick, let's say one of the things, and then give the citation. So I have given some examples here. So in a similar format, you have to give the citation for the image as well. And once you do this, you can upload. And after it is uploaded, if you click that uploaded image, you will get a handle here. So you simply copy this and paste it into the article. So summary, I'm pasting it. Now if I do a preview, I should see this image in the summary. See, previously this image was not there. Now I pasted this. Now I can see the image. And you can also do a diff before you save. Make sure that you know everything is proper. So what are the changes I made to this article? All the change I've done is added a new image. So that is what the diff is showing. So you just like, you know, before checking in your GitHub, you do a diff of your changes. So similar concept, you diff of here, you are doing diff of your writing before submitting it to the system. Another thing is saving the draft. So today these two will be more or less same to you, but at later point you will see the difference. You know, once you become a reputed author in the system, saving will create a new version and it will be visible to all the other authors. So that is what saving a version is all about, and all the versions are captured here, and you can also do a diff from one version to the previous version. So saving creates a new version in the system, whereas saving a draft, that is work in progress. Only you can see it. Others cannot see this. So you can save as many drafts as you want, you know, overwrite the previous drafts, and moderator or reviewer will not get any mail notification. Only when you save, moderator is going to get an email saying that it is, you know, maybe you want to take a look to review it. But under the rewards program, we will review only after all the review warnings are gone and it meets 1200 words. Before that, we may not actually do a review. Let's see. Any questions? Now we can take questions.
Yes, I have a question.
Yeah.
This would require online editing, right? I usually write offline. So
yeah, that is a very good question. Now I have done all this online, right?
Right.
But actually this article, let's go to this article, Java, which we started, everything we did online. But right. You want to do offline editing because actually your research will take maybe 1 or 2 days. You don't want to be editing like this. Right. So what you do, you copy the content. You use this one.
Okay.
Copy the content, go to your text editor. I am using VS Code here.
Okay.
A plain text editor, not even Microsoft Word, because Microsoft Word will do other formatting. We don't want that. plain yeah, text editor, paste it. You get the whole thing as a text.
Right.
And this is nothing but markdown format. So I will save it locally. I will say java.md markdown format. Okay. And then once I do this, my text editor will automatically highlight. And I can also, you know, preview if I want. That is depending on my text editor, summary, discussion, milestones, sample code. So some amount of preview also is possible within your text editor.
Okay, thank you.
Right. So so I can do all the editing offline. Actually, this is how I do it normally. And when I am ready, I come back to the system, import content. And all the edits get imported into the system. So you see, these are the lines I wrote offline. Now they are imported into the system. Are you with me? So all the, all the edits can be done offline and then you import it. There is only one danger here. Because this is a collaborative platform, let's say you copied the content yesterday night, and today morning you did a lot of edits offline and then you are importing the content. But what if in between yesterday night and today morning, the reviewer has come and made some changes to the article? If you blindly import like this, you will overwrite the changes done by the reviewer between last night and today morning. So to avoid that, before you submit your changes, always do a diff. Make sure that the diff shows only your changes. If you see something funny, that means you have not noticed that somebody has come in between and created another version. Right? So that is important. Always do a diff. Always look at which was the previous version from where you took a copy. So that will ensure that you are not overwriting somebody else's content. So anyway, right. Typically, for the rewards program, it's not going to happen, because once, let's say, data science article is assigned to you, nobody else is going to edit this. They will not be allowed to edit. Right? But moderator still has the power to edit if he or she wants, but they will refrain from editing. In case they did some minor correction by mistake, let's say they noticed a spelling correction, they did it without informing you. Then there is a potential that you may override the moderator's changes. So that's why we recommend always do a diff before submitting it. You had a question? Somebody had a question?
Yeah, I had a question that whenever there is an edit, it will always create a new version, right?
When you save it here, it will create a new version. Okay, but if you save as a draft, it is only internal to you. Only you can see it.
Okay, so if I need to work offline, then maybe I could save a draft and work off the draft.
Yeah, actually, if you but you see, draft is not visible. Just saving as a draft doesn't mean that others can't edit. They can still edit.
Okay.
Yeah. Draft doesn't do anything. Instead of draft, you can do everything offline. Just okay. Export it, do everything offline. When you are ready, you import everything and complete the version.
Yeah, my question was related to the a possible risk of overwriting. So for that, I wanted to ask, if I have saved something and then I'm working offline, and if a moderator makes an edit, it would appear as a new version, right?
Yeah, it will appear as a new version, yes.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Only thing is, you may not notice it. Like, you may not click this to check whether the new version occurred. So for that reason, I'm saying. But if you are tracking, let's say you exported version 5, and then today morning you came and saw that version 6 has been created, then you are smart. Okay, then you will do a diff here to figure out what is going on.
Right.
But like I said, it's going to be a very rare case. Firstly, non-reviewers will not be able to edit once the article is assigned to you. And the reviewers will, they have been told not to edit, actually. So that means you will be the only editor until it is published. So, okay, any other questions before we move on?
Yes, Arvind.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask that while you know working offline, are there any other platforms on which we could work on, or we have to use this system only for working offline?
Offline, you use your normal notepad. I use VS Code text editor, but you can also use your normal notepad. So there's no need to go online, because almost every system will have a simple notepad.
Okay.
Yeah, notepad is more than enough to edit this.
Okay, then how do we export the content from, you know, this offline notepad to your system? I didn't get it very well.
Okay. So now I'll go back to notepad in case you are comfortable with notepad. But there are today many powerful editors. So notepad I'm using. And let's say now I select and copy everything from my notepad. Okay. I go back here. There is a tab, import content. Can you see
it? Yes.
So I click this, I get this pop-up, and here I paste it, whatever I copied from my notepad.
Okay.
And then I say import. Now the whole thing is imported here.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. I can show you one more time from a complete fresh article. See, I'm starting a new article, add article.
Okay.
As you can see here, add article has nothing. There is absolutely no content. If I preview, everything is empty.
No.
And I import. Now I got the whole article in here. Only thing is the title has disappeared, because title is not part of what you copied. Title is outside this. Another thing that has disappeared is tags. So you have to add back the tags. So create the tags, add the tags, and change description, first version, right? And then, so now if you preview, you will see the whole content that you copied from your editor has come in here.
Okay.
So one more point is that when you create your versions, don't simply say first version. First version is fine, because it makes sense. But you see the kind of comments which other people give when they create a version, adding content with images, adding a new item in further reading. So the change description should describe what change you made, so that it's easy for the reviewers to review. Maybe between two versions, you added a new image or changed a milestone or corrected the grammar. So you describe those things here. Okay. So that's it about this. Any other questions? So we have covered creating your first article. So already we are like running beyond the time limit. So I don't know whether we should continue. What do you feel, Ramanathan? Anybody else? Any other? Do you want? So the next thing is author tips, which is researching tips and writing tips. But this is already covered, in the author guidelines, which some of you have read. Here we are covering it in a little bit more detail. So possibly the slides are self-explanatory, but if you want, I can quickly cover in 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Or we can use the time for more Q&A.
Let's see if there is Q&A, first we'll address that.
Yeah. Anybody has further questions? So like I said, writing process can begin on 13th of December. You will get an email.
Looks like there is no queue questions.
Okay. We'll wrap up in 10 minutes. I'll go through these slides rather quickly. So you see, when you are writing, both are important, research and writing. So you will do a little bit of research and then you may start writing. When you start writing, you may realize that, there are some things that you don't understand, or you discovered some extra things. So then you will go back to the research phase. So the process is rather iterative. you know, sometimes you will be in research phase, sometimes in writing phase, and you will be going back and forth. So some research tips. Researching is nothing more than finding what the topic is about, what you need to cover in the article. So use various keyword searches in Google, right? Don't restrict to only a small set of keywords. If you go to, suppose you are writing an article on, let's say, Python, you can go to the article on Python published at Wikipedia, and Wikipedia at the bottom of the page will have a list of references which were used to write the Wikipedia article. So that can be a useful shortcut for you to do your research. Instead of Googling, you can get a good set of references from Wikipedia itself if you go down to the bottom of that page. That is provided the Wikipedia article is there and it is nicely written. So this is a normal keyword web search, but you can also search for images and videos, which will give you a different set of matches. And some of these images can be useful for embedding in uploading to the article. So now if you search at Google Scholar, you will get a lot of academic papers, which is very essential for getting to the root of the topic, like canonical sources that led to the development of that field, right? For example, you are writing a paper on an article on ImageNet. It's very important that you read the original paper, you know, which introduced ImageNet to the world. So, you know, there are some articles where, you know, you have to read the canonical sources. So that kind of thing, you can get it at Google Scholar. Read primary sources, start, but secondary sources are easier. So you should start with secondary sources. What are primary and secondary? I will cover in the next slide probably. And choose reputable sources. Don't choose shady sources for your references.
Yep. Anup has a question, Arvind.
Go ahead. Yeah.
My question is, if an author creates an image.
Yeah. Then it will be simply flagged as source Devopedia 2021.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But the system knows author has created the image. So that means the contribution is not lost. So later, if you want to highlight that, we can do that. So some keywords for research. So all this will help you cover the topic in a complete manner. What are primary and secondary sources? So primary sources are typically more difficult to read and understand, but sometimes some of the primary sources must be read because they are essential to the topic. So research papers, IEEE, ACM, Elsevier, archive, books, official docs. Suppose we are talking about MongoDB, you better read the MongoDB official docs, videos and tutorials from the official site. Historical records, for example, emails on mailing lists. So this is important for writing the milestones, for example, standard documents, press releases. So let's say you are talking about some feature of an NVIDIA GPU. So NVIDIA may have released a press release. So that becomes again a primary source, because it's coming directly from NVIDIA. What are secondary sources? Typically, people who have read the primary sources and then they are writing about it, they are secondary sources. So tech blogs, Wikipedia, news articles, tutorials, videos. So there are plenty of this. Of course, primary sources are very valuable. They have a lot of credibility. Secondary sources, not so much. But still, there are some articles in the secondary sources which are pretty good. So we can use them as sources. So examples of good and bad sources. Good sources, official sites of tech companies, reputed publishing houses, reputed tech magazines, blogs, Coursera, Khan Academy, conference proceedings, recordings. Some acceptable sources, it's not that great, but we can accept them because some of their articles, you know, are good. Geeks for Geeks, Simply Learn, etc., etc. some sources which we perceive as low quality, W3 schools, Java T-Point, IntelliPat, for various reasons, we don't regard them as good sources, so don't use them in your articles as references. And then Quora, Stack Overflow, Medium, Hacker Noon, etc., etc., YouTube videos, these are all good, provided they have a lot of claps, likes, shares, and views. But don't select any of these sources if they don't have any claps, any likes, any shares or views. Because this is an indication that, you know, the community, how well these articles are respected by the community. So don't select any sources which have few recognition from the community. Writing tips, include images, write in simple English, use short sentences, read published articles. So Devopedia, a lot of articles are published. If you read them, you know, that gives you some sense how you should write for Devopedia. So the reading existing articles will make you a better writer. Cite your sources, choose facts over opinions, cite your sources, define but also explain, rephrase, don't copy. So when we say that you are, you know, using source information, you are not copying it word for word. You are only summarizing it, paraphrasing it, rephrasing it. So that is important. And be technically precise. Some examples, so I'll not cover this, but this is important. This is actually directly taken from Wikipedia. We have not made any changes to this. Neutrally cover the topic and give sources, citations, so that reader can verify, you know, what you are talking about. And not only verify, reader can also get more information if they go to the source. Okay, images. This sort of an image, it's a no. Why? Because it's a marketing image. It doesn't add any value to the article. So use an image which explains the concept, explains, supports the answer, supports the summary or the milestone. So use images that explain the concept. So some examples, bad, complicated English, nothing grammatically wrong here, but it's too complex for Devopedia. Furthermore, large volumes of water are also required for the process of extraction. Designers took the decision to incorporate error checking into wrapper code. How can you simplify this in plain English? Extraction also requires large volumes of water. Designers decided to check for errors in wrapper code. So what has happened? Took the decision, which is unnecessarily formal, has been modified to decided, which is a verb, right? Incorporate error checking, which is the error checking is a noun phrase. This has been converted into a verb, check for errors, which makes it very simple and easy to understand. Same thing here, process of extraction has been removed. Furthermore, you know, the whole thing is simplified. Extraction also requires large volumes of water. So there is a whole band of followers who are promoting how to write in plain English. This is not something Devopedia has invented. This is very well known, how to write in plain English. So lots of examples you will see if you go here. Short sentences. Typically, we recommend sentences should be less than 20 words. 15 words, even better. 10 words, even better. So you read this sentence, how complex it is. 44 words. So we are not changing the sentence in any major way. We have simply split it up into four sentences, which makes it easier to read and understand. So, you know, from 44, it has become 45 words, but now we have four sentences and the whole information is easier to read and understand because the brain has limited capacity to store. So by the time you get to the end of the sentence, you don't know where you started. But then here, it's easier for anyone to understand. What is wrong here? In such conditions, an exception is raised by the software. Grammatically, nothing wrong. But again, we should be using active voice rather than passive voice. This is known as passive voice. How can we improve this? In such conditions, the software raises an exception. So instead of saying exception is raised by, the whole thing is reversed. Software raises an exception. So this is recommended not only in Devopedia. You go to any technical writing course, they will teach you this. Use parallel structure. So what is the problem here? For performance, we recommend C language and using more RAM. So C language is actually a noun. Whereas using more RAM, this is a verb phrase. Using is a inflection of the verb. So now, you know, what is happening is in one case you are using a noun, in another case you are using a verb form, and then you are connecting them by an AND. So this is not recommended. So you use parallel structure. Either both of them should be a verb or both of them should be nouns. So how do you change it? For performance, we recommend C language and more RAM. So using has been deleted. Or if you want to use the verb form, you do this. For performance, we recommend using C language and installing more RAM. Okay. So this is using noun forms. This is using verb forms. But the structure should be parallel. Define but also explain. So when you are writing, you know, there are some cases where you have to define something. So definitions are good. It helps people, you know, grasp something or remember something easily. But then, you know, a lot of times definitions are not good enough. Explanations are better. So I'll give you an example here. gRPC is a high performance open source universal RPC framework. This is exactly how it will appear in the gRPC official documentation. But, you know, if somebody is a developer who is exposed to RPC and RPC frameworks, they can understand what this is all about. But somebody who is a beginner, let's say a student who is fresh out of college or still studying, this will completely go above their head. Because they don't understand what is gRPC, they don't understand what is an RPC framework. So definitions are good in Devopedia, but we prefer explanations. So how is this written in Devopedia? We give a little bit of context to help people understand. gRPC is a framework that enables the implementation of highly scalable and performant application whose parts are distributed over a network. So this itself tells you where it fits, an application which is distributed over a network. Then it comes to what the framework actually does. The framework abstracts away the low-level networking details from the app so that app developers can focus on the application logic. Developers need not worry about how one part calls a functionality in another remote part. So gRPC takes care of this and enables more responsible real-time apps. So it gives more context, more explanation, and it kind of supports the definition. So you may also use the definition in the article, but don't stop at definition. You have to give the explanation. What is the opposite of explanation? So all these things you should avoid when you are writing. Conflicting ideas are perfectly okay. So don't be partial to specific viewpoints. So here's an example. Is explainability in AI the same as interpretability? Some of you may be knowing this topic. And the answer is there is no single definition. What is explainable AI? What is interpretable AI? How are these two terms same or different? So what we do, we give multiple answers in the same question. For the same question. So the answer starts with the dominant idea. Like many sources may be saying this is what interpretability is all about, this is what explainability all about. So you start the answer with the dominant idea, then you move towards alternative viewpoints. So this is what we expect when you are researching, right? You capture all the different viewpoints. It's okay if this one doesn't agree with this. That's perfectly fine. We are giving references to the sources. Here we are saying, in fact, the author's name. Rudin says this, Lipton, because these are all well-known authors who have been in the field. So we can use their names. Rudin says like this, Lipton says like this. And then this set of authors, Montovan et al., talk about interpretability like this. So alternative viewpoints are also captured. More examples. The new deployment resulted in a failure, too formal, unnecessarily complex. So you can simply say the new deployment failed. C++ is a, so this is ambiguity. I like the language, but which language? Is it C++ or Java? So here I am making it explicit. I like Java. There is support for multiple threads in Java. So this is very common mistake beginners make. So this whole sentence can be supported or rephrased like this. Java supports multiple threads. Visualization updates are blazingly fast. What is blazingly fast? It's very ambiguous. So as a technical writer, we have to be precise. So visualization updates are faster by 50%. So when we are writing for technical audience, we have to be precise. This is not acceptable. Blazingly fast, no way we can publish this on Devopedia. So here there is some explanation how to write citations. Author name, typically last name, comma, first name. Then year of publication, title of the paper in double quotes with a full stop or question mark or exclamation before the quotes. Detail of publication, is it a blog or maybe the name of the conference, something like that. Website or publisher's name, IEEE, in this case HubSpot or Geeks for Geeks or BBC. So that is a website or publisher's name. Date of publication. In some cases, it would be published on October 26th, but later it was edited. So you capture that also, updated on this particular date. When you access the URL, and then the URL in parentheses. So with this, you should be able to write it. And there are enough reference examples in the author guidelines. This is an important question. I know some of you are from SEO background. Right? So even in the interview, some of you asked, what about SEO? Do I optimize the content for SEO? So no, you don't. Actually, you have to leave this to Devopedia. And even the Google SEO starter guide says this. What is the most important thing in SEO? Creating compelling and useful content that will likely influence your website more than any other factor discussed here. So as an author, you don't have a job to optimize for SEO. Right, that is done by the Devopedia system. What is your job? Your job is to write easy to read articles, organize your topics clearly, write content that's factually accurate, clearly written, comprehensive. Optimize your content for users, not for search engines. Choose descriptive text for anchor text. Suppose you are putting a link, choose a descriptive text. So these are your responsibilities. So don't worry about SEO and keywords and all that. Readers are not looking for that. Search engines are looking for SEOs and stuff like that. That we will take care. Your job as an author is to write for users. Users are your audience. Don't think of search engines. And who is the audience, to be more clear? Suppose you are writing an article on data science. Developer is your audience, but project managers and lay people can also read your article because this is a very high level article. So you have to think of all these three people. You know, if you write for the layperson, even better. That means if this guy understands, surely project managers and developers will also understand. Okay. But then there are some articles, REST API to GraphQL migration. I don't think a layperson is going to be interested in this. Surely developer will be interested. Maybe project manager will be interested, or for that matter, a product manager. They will be interested to know how to do this migration. You know, and does it make sense for my project? But then you go one level deeper, Python data types, which is a highly technical topic. I don't think even project manager will be interested in this. So then it is very clear when you are writing this, you are writing only for the developer. So keep these different types of audiences in mind. developer's journey and not look at it, you can go through it. So finally, why Devopedia? Because of these reasons. So we don't have a paywall, anyone can read the content. And customer is king. Who is our customer? Reader. So we are writing for the reader. Like I said earlier, the more time you put in as a writer, an easier time the reader will have in understanding the topic. We follow open licensing. We are not protecting this content only for ourselves. And we are non-profit and managed by Devopedia. And what's in it for you as authors? You get recognized because your name appears. It's not ghostwriting. But having said that, if you don't want to show to the world who you are, then you make your profile, keep your profile private. And you can showcase your profile in your resume, get paid for learning with guidance from reviewers. So especially for some of you who are freshers, beginners to tech writing, we will help you. We are not seeing you as simply as writers. We are also seeing you as students or people kickstarting your career rather. So you, we will help you learn your topic of interest. If you are interested in cloud computing, you pick articles in cloud computing. Our reviewers will guide you. And through the process, you know, once you have written, let's say 5 to 10 articles, you will become an expert in cloud computing. And that may also enable you to attend interviews, you know, for that kind of roles. So you will become better in a particular field. So that is what I see as the main value add for freshers, students, beginners. And at a later point, you can get involved in other activities in Devopedia. We have many other things. We have weekly tech talks or regular tech talks. Sometimes if COVID, once COVID is gone, you know, we'll also have classroom workshops. So a lot of other initiatives happening in Devopedia. Sorry, it took a little longer than planned. What is the time? But I have covered everything. And I hope this overview will help you get started with the writing.